my dear classmates, and to our passionate Professor Dr. Laura Nay Viranas. To everyone, have a pleasant day. Today, I am going to deliver my report about the life and contribution of Mr. Johann Friedrich Herbart. But before that, let me introduce first myself. By the way, I am JCM David, a teacher at Jose Soriano Elementary School in the municipality of La Castellana. Okay, so without further ado, let's start our lecture. My lecture this day. Okay, so but before that, let's have first an activity. This is a 5 minutes activity. So direction, arrange the scrambled letters to form a word which is related to our topic this day. Okay, so fellow classmates, you can pause for a while this video presentation while answering the activity. Then afterwards, you can play it and check if your answers matches with the answer key. Okay, so I hope that you have already done with your activity. So let's check if your answers matches with the answer key. So number one, Johann. Number two, Friedrich. Number three, Herbart. Number four, presentation. Number five, preparation. Number six, association. Number seven, generalization. Eight, application. 9, apperceptive. And 10, Herbartianism. Okay, so congratulations everyone for the job well done. So let's start our let's start with the life of Johann Friedrich Herbart. So Johann Friedrich Herbart was the son of a state councilor, Thomas Gerhard Herbart, and Luzia Margarita Herbart. Johann Friedrich Herbart was a German philosopher, psychologist, and the founder of pedagogy as an academic discipline. Herbart is now remembered amongst the post-Kantian philosophers, mostly as making the greatest contrast to Hegel, in particular in relation to aesthetic. Growing up as a fragile child because of an unfortunate accident, Herbart was taught by his mother at home until at the age of 12. Then, he continued his schooling at the gymnasium for 6 years and showed interest in philosophy and logic. Then, his education continued at the University of Jena, whereupon he studied philosophy. After graduating, Herbart worked as a tutor of the three sons of a governor general at Interlaken, Switzerland, from 1797 to 1800. During which period, he made the acquaintance to Pestalozzi, becoming the licentiate of the University of Göttingen in 1802. He was appointed extraordinary professor there in 1805. At the close of 1808, he became Kant's successor as a professor at Königsberg. Regardless of his relentless studying, he met an 18-year-old English girl named Mary Drake. He became acquainted with her and asked for her hand to marry him and to live a happy life, with Mary supporting all of her husband's pursuits and contribution to the field of pedagogy and psychology. Okay, so let's proceed to philosophy of education. Herbart's influence on educational theory is very important at the present time. He believed that the mind was the sum total of all ideas which entered into one's conscious life. He emphasized the importance of both the physical and the human environment in the development of the mind. So Herbert believed that the nature of a child will greatly affect his or her development. Ganda naman sa loob lang nature versus nurture. So, ang environment, kung diin nag-star ang bata, maka-apekto gid na saya sa iyang development. Ang bata nga nagdako sa squatters, nang puro lang ilinaway, aga pa do, hindi siya nang itanay na, later on, ma-adapt na niya sa bata. To Herbert, ideas were central to the process. He felt they grouped themselves into what he called apperceptive masses. By assimilation, new ideas could enter the mind through association with similar ideas already present. This was what he called the learning process. In Platonic tradition, Herbert espoused that the only by becoming productive citizens could people fulfill their true purpose. He believed that every child is born with a unique potential, his individuality, but that this potential remained unfulfilled until it was analyzed and transformed by education in accordance with what he regarded as the accumulated values of civilization. Only formalized, rigorous education could, he believed, provide the framework for moral and intellectual development. So he emphasized that only formalized or formal education will develop the child morally and intellectually. Ano mga gambal ka nga? There are three types of education, di ba? As we have already learned. We have the formal, the informal, and non-formal education. So, maghambal ka non-formal education, na muna sabi lang example lang else. While formal education, it is an education wherein ang bata may enroll gid siya, makadtugid siya sa eskwelahan, the learning will take place in a four-walled classroom, may curriculum gid nasunod, may maestra, muna sa formal education. While informal education, naman yan ang natunhan mo lang through life experiences. But Herbert believed that only formalized, rigorous education will develop the child holistically. So he also cited the 5K ideas which compose his concept of individual maturation. Where? Inner freedom. So magambal ka, inner freedom is the capacity of individuals to assume the responsibility they have, making conscious, adapt. Decisions. Perfection. Magambal naman ka perfection. Flawless. Perfect. Okay. Benevolence. Benevolence is the quality of being well-meaning or kindness. Then justice, equity, or recompense. According to Herbert, abilities were not innate, but could be instilled. So a thorough education could provide the framework for moral and intellectual development. In order to develop an educational paradigm that would provide an intellectual base that would lead to a consciousness of social responsibility. Herbert advocated 5 formal steps in teaching. His theory of education was called as Herbertianism. So with what is, no? Human abilities were not innate, but it could be learned, through formal education. Halimbawa, pag bata mo, sagad ka na bladayon mag-kayos sa mga electronics na yun. Example, sagad ka naman kayos ang mga duba nga TV, duba nga cellphone, di ba hindi? But then, through formalized education, the child will learn that skill and become a productive citizen. Okay, so let's proceed to the 5 formal steps in teaching by Herbert. Okay, Herbertian method of teaching. Herbert advocated 5 formal steps in teaching. Number 1, preparation. A process of relating new material to be learned to relevant past ideas or memories in order to give the pupil a vital interest in the topic under consideration. So magkita sa lesson plan natin, di ba, ganyan na pirmi ang motivation or engagement. So dapat, kung nag-aubra kita sa motivation natin, dapat ginatanawid natin ang mga past experiences ng bata. Ang motivation dapat natin, well, related to their past experiences. Eh kung hindi na relate, hindi sila ka-relate, matanga-tanga ng bata. Wala sila interest. Diba? Istoryahan mo sila karon bisang mga sapat sa zoo to ya. Nguwain sa ganit ka kadto sa zoo. Istoryahan mo siya. Sang masami niya makita. Makita sa environment niya. Makita sa community nila. Then the child will gain interest to your topic. Number 2, presentation. Presenting new material by means of concrete objects or actual experiences. So mag-present kita. Yun masulod siguro nga ito, yung natawag ng mga visual aids. Mga multimedia and audio media aids mo da. Kay mas ma-arouse natin ang interest ng bata, if, especially grade school pupils, ma-arouse mong interest nila if you have your visual aids. Concrete. Makita din nila. Number 2, association. Number 3, association. Thorough assimilation of the new idea through comparison with former ideas and consideration of their similarities and differences in order to implant the new idea into mind. Number 4, generalization. A procedure especially important to the instruction of adolescents and designed to develop the mind beyond the level of perception and the concrete. Number 5, application. Using acquired knowledge not in a pure utilitarian way, but so that every learned idea becomes a part of the functional mind and in aid to a clear, vital interpretation of life. This step is presumed possible only if the student immediately applies the new idea, making it his own. So, munisang one of the most important steps in Herbartian method of teaching, ng bata dapat, they are going to apply what they have learned in the four-walled classroom in a real life situation. Advantages of the Herbartian approach to lesson planning. Number 1, it is simple and easy approach for lesson planning. It is useful in the teaching of all school subjects. It incorporates the principle of learning. It is logical and psychological approach of lesson planning. It employs the previous knowledge of students for imparting the new knowledge. It employs the inductive, deductive, and analytic, synthetic method of teaching. It is useful in achieving the cognitive objectives of teaching. Once again, my dear classmates, the 5 formal steps introduced by Johann Friedrich Herbart are: number 1, we have the preparation. Number 2, we have the presentation. Number 3, we have the association. Number 4, we have the generalization. And number 5, we have the application. So makita tama na sa ato yung lesson plan. Diba? Okay? Thank you for listening and have a good day. Stay safe always and always be positive, but always stay negative to COVID. Thank you, everyone.